Like a bell pepper used to be $1.50. Now it's $2.
Yes, we had stuff. We had the bell. Right. My wife, one of my favorite meals from my wife is stuffed peppers.
Mm.
And we had that last night. And she had these beautiful stuff. And all of a sudden, it used to be like 20, I don't know, I'm showing my age here, maybe 29 cents a pepper. All of a sudden, a little bag of four or something like that is $4, $5, $6. Have you noticed produce and meats and things in the supermarket? All of a sudden, are things going up? Are things costing us more? Is there a dollar shrinking?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's called a recession and a depression, and we're eventually it's going to get a lot worse before it gets better. Okay, I'm not a doom and gloom guy, and I think there's a lot of upside to a recession from the viewpoint of investors. It gives us all a little breathing room. It helps us to clean up garbage inventory, get rid of the properties. If you have properties that you're holding that are marginal, they're more trouble and maintenance, and you're not making enough profit, now is the time, exactly now, actually 2 months ago, now is the time to clean house. Get rid of the properties that are not performing or are super high maintenance right now. Now is the time to clean house, build up your credit, and build up your cash reserves, okay? Because what we're seeing right now is going to slowly, it's like a little snowball going down a hill. It's going to get bigger and bigger. It's going to build up momentum as we see it. Going into 2023, it's going to get a lot worse. Historically, recessions take about 18 months. That's a year and a half to burn out. And that's from the statistics from the Department of Labor or Treasury. I read it. It goes back to 1924. So it's 18 months. And assuming that this recession probably started sometime in the early of the first quarter this year, we're going to see it well through 2023 into 2024. Politics has a lot to do with this too. Or is the government going to get more conservative in their spending? Are they going to spend billions of dollars on the sex life of an anteater research project, or are they going to start cutting back spending? You can see right now the Fed went up 0.75 on mortgage rates less this month. You're going to see another big jump in July, okay, probably.
Right.
Anybody else have, what are you guys seeing out there? Henry, good morning. Henry Serrano. Henry, you do a lot of traveling. Henry is one of my superstar students. I've known Henry at least 10 years when you were like 16 years old or something, right?
Hey, Claude, how you doing?
Yeah, Henry, you do a lot of traveling. What are you seeing? Oh, you've got to give us the airport report. I mean, because you live on airplanes. What's going on?
Oh yeah, it was definitely packed. I was there on Friday. I'm here in Ohio right now, taking a look at a couple of properties. But yeah, it was definitely packed. We're seeing major delays. I was delayed probably about an hour and a half out of Dallas, but definitely the airports are packed and crowded.
You know, how about the prices of airline tickets?
Yeah, I mean, I'm probably paying close to $800 or $900 a ticket, you know, from Fresno to Detroit. So definitely seeing these prices go up because there's less inventory. You know, they're canceling a lot of flights. And the other thing too is locations. They're cutting back quite a bit on the locations, you know, for the flights. So
I've noticed that I'm a big fan of Southwest Airlines. Normally it's a great flight from Denver to Raleigh, Durham. I pay about $150 to $300 business class, you know, pre-boarding with Southwest. I like that because I can get on fast, get off fast. And for me, time is money. Now that same flight, they've cut back on the flights and the flights are full and it's gone from $150 to $300 to $664 one way. They've literally doubled the flights. Jessica, you've been doing a lot of flying. What did you see traveling in Europe and stuff? How did you see the recession affecting Europe?
It's expensive. And also there's lots of delays and they're having trouble finding enough staff for doing all the airline duties. And sometimes flights are even getting canceled. So right now it's a little bit crazy right now.
It is crazy. Anybody else? This is your time. This is open forum. Brandon Simmons is in the room. Brandon, can you talk right now? Are you in a good place?
Yeah. Yeah. We have a brand new puppy. So I was actually taking him for a little
potty break there. I don't know.
A suggestion, take him for a lot of potty breaks.
Yeah, that's what we're doing. I just got back from Houston and we did have a delay. What's interesting, a lot of the real estate investors out there, there's about 300 people in the room, a lot of top-notch folks, and a lot of people are moving from in-house employees, like having people in their office, to moving 100% virtual and getting overseas people, because it seems like that the in-house people are wanting a much, much higher commission and a much more higher part of the profit of the deal. And so they're finding that the overseas people have a lot more loyalty. They stick around longer. It's just, I think everyone's trying to cut their expenses down right now.
Exactly. Very much so. It's amazing to me. There's such a shortage. How come we're having a shortage of employees? Does anyone know the answer? What's going on? Everywhere you go, help wanted signs. The hamburger places are playing $17 to $20. What's going on?
Wendy's is $21 an hour.
Wow.
Is it because unemployment is paying?
Well, what's the cause of unemployment, though? Hello?
I think a lot of people are trying to work from home or trying to get jobs where they have that flexibility, and they're basically looking for higher wages now because of inflation.
Have you heard Elon Musk at the Tesla plant said, if you're not coming into work, you don't have a job? He basically laid the law down. Why did he do that?
Well, one is he feels like that there's better communication in his company whenever people are in the same office. That's one of the biggest ones.
Yeah. I think
it's true.
I love working from home. I'm much more productive working from home than getting in my car, putting on a suit, commuting. I did that corporate stuff. And for my personality, working from home is wonderful. But if you owned a company and you need people communicating, networking, we always hear the thing about teamwork. Do you really get that on a Zoom cooperative?
No. And the reality too is you can't tell if they really are working without having the right type of software. They have on Amazon, they sell special mouse activators that will move your mouse around so it looks like you're always active on the screen.
How about the competitive spirit? When you're in an office and you have your peers and they're working harder than you and they're getting promotions and things like that, isn't there something about being in that competitive environment and being in front of your boss and showing him or her how hard you're working and how productive you are? I mean, who are companies going to promote and pay more money to? I know the culture says home, we want to work at home, but really the high performance people, where do they really want to be?
In the office, I agree.
In the office, yeah. I asked Brandon specially. Brandon, you just, I think it was this weekend, you attended a special real estate seminar on the recession and everything. Could you share with us some of the high points of what you learned? I'm really interested in this.
So I don't know if you saw the news today. They're talking about another 0.75 basis points for the bumping up another. They're talking that it could hit over double digits by the end of the year. So your mortgage interest rates will be over 10%.
Yeah.
So, and that's to kind of help pull back inflation, right? That's part of it. Hold on a second. Come here, puppy.
He's puppy sitting.
And then let's see what else. A lot of people are talking about creative. So many more. There's a lot of wholesalers at this event, so they're used to just, you know, marketing like crazy for the ugly houses and selling them to cash buyers. Well, a lot of them are selling to hedge funds, and a lot of the hedge funds are not buying. In fact, some of the Wall Street firms are talking about liquidating some of their inventory, like 3,000 houses at a time and stuff like that.
Say that again. That was pivotal. That was really big.
So a lot of Wall Street funds that were buying from a lot of these investors that were paying top dollar, now they're liquidating the houses.
Wow.
Why? So it's going to put more inventory on the market. which will drop prices.
Why are they doing that?
So prices are high, and then
they're trying to take advantage of the prices. The prices are the highest that they've ever been for most places, and so they're coming back.
So if investment companies, pension funds, companies that have unlimited amounts of money to buy real estate, if they're not buying right now, the obvious question is, why are they not buying? They're not making the profits they promised or envisioned.
Exactly. I was shocked at how high, what percentage a lot of the funds were buying at, like Zillow, Open Door, OfferPad, Amherst, Titus Capital, like a lot of these that were buying, they were buying really high. Like if you think about a wholesale deal, they typically would be under 70% of retail. The funds were buying over 90%, legitimately over 90% of retail. So, and it benefited to them because here's a couple stats for you. There's over 16 million homes vacant in the United States right now.
Vacant? You mean investment?
Vacant house. These are probably houses that were bought by funds and stuff that aren't on the market yet. So they're in that in-between stage.
Okay. Construction, pre-marketing, things like that.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's in Florida alone, there's 1.6 million or 1.7 million.
Hey, Brandon, where can I look for those statistics at? Or how can
If you
find
Google it real quick, if you just let me see if I can find it, I'll try to put.
Someone put it in the chat box for me, please.
Yeah, if there's several articles on that. Let's see, 16. I'm trying to do it on my phone. Sorry. And vacant homes. Newsweek. Here you go, Newsweek. I'm going to share this with you real quick.
Your video's off for a second.
Okay, let me see if I can share my... Maybe I can share my screen real quick, Claude.
Here, let me...
I think you have to give me permission.
Here you go.
Nope, it's not letting me.
Yeah, hold on.
There it goes.
There you go.
I think I got it now. All right. Now we're sharing my screen. So this is Newsweek. There are 16 million. Can you see my screen, Claude?
Yeah. 16 million empty homes.
According to LendingTree study published this month.
What?
So, you know, you're talking about there's no inventory. It's not true. There's inventory. It's just we're in that in-between stage.
Okay. And where is this inventory right now? Is it in urban areas, in the country, in the suburbs? Where are we starting to see this change of inventory?
So there's a lot in a lot of the big... Oops.
There you go.
There's a lot in the big states. So like if you think about most of Wall Street funds, the hedge funds, were buying in a lot of these big cities like Tampa, Florida, Orlando, Florida, Phoenix, Arizona. Like in Phoenix, Arizona, more than 44% or higher were of homes bought this year were all bought by investors and LLCs.
Okay. And that's slowing down, you learned from the seminar this weekend.
Yeah.
What was the name of that seminar?
Real Estate Entrepreneurs.
Okay. On there. So they said the inventory is increasing right now, and the spending has been drastically reduced up to what, 16 million vacant homes? Is that, did you say six or
there's,
six?
There's six, one, six, 16.
16 million. That's a lot. That's a lot of homes. That's a radical change. We're starting. What I've been noticing in certain markets is the listing time. You know, when someone threw a property on the MLS or something, it was multiple bids. It was a bidding auction. It was higher than the price. Now we're starting to see I heard from Lonnie and Chantel that properties now in Phoenix, which had a major upheaval in price structure, all of a sudden the properties are 3, 4, 5 weeks listing now.
Okay. So according to the Fred, you ever heard of the Fred data?
Vaguely.
It's the Federal Reserve out of St. Louis.
Okay.
So they're talking, it's a 9-month supply of houses nationwide. We have a 9-month supply of houses nationwide. Now, certain markets won't see that yet. In Phoenix, Arizona, we tripled our inventory in 30 days.
Wow. And what else is the factor? Okay, so the vacancies and the listings are getting, vacancies are increasing, listings are getting longer. And with the interest rates, every time it goes up 0.75, it goes up another, you know, what's the, one of my mortgage people, what's a mortgage go for now? 4 or 5, yeah. Is it 4%, 5%? What's a mortgage now?
It's over 6%.
Over 6%, okay. Is that a variable rate or a fixed rate?
Fixed, 30.
Okay, fixed 30. What are we going to see as the interest rates go up and the affordability factor gets smaller, less people can afford this mortgage? Okay, the down payments are astronomical because the prices are high and the interest rates, the payments per month, might go out of sight of their budget now. So we have a smaller buying pool as we're seeing with inventory increasing right now. Okay, we're starting, you know, it's...
I was going to say, there's a weird anomaly here in Maricopa County. We have people that are like in Scottsdale, that's kind of like a nice area that a lot of people want to live. Let's say houses are around 600,000-700,000. Those houses are sitting now. They're taking longer and they're dropping the prices. Houses under the $400,000 range still move. So your retail buyers are still going to be buying. The people that need loans to buy those more expensive homes, those prices are going to drop for sure. Mm-hmm. And what's another weird thing is I have one of my friends, they do fix and flip at the high-end luxury homes like in Arcadia, which is like they'll buy a house for like $1 million. They'll spend a ton of money on it, or maybe they'll buy vacant land and then they'll go and put a new house on it, basically like a brand new build, and they're selling for $2 or $3 million. Those houses, believe it or not, are actually still selling right now because there's people moving in that are paying 100% cash. They're not even getting loans. Mm-hmm. So it's a weird anomaly.
Do you see this as something very subtle, very stealth-like? We're going to see this market change very slowly, seductively, or is it just going to boom, hit us in the head?
It already happened. That's the biggest message. It already happened and we didn't realize it. It's already a buyer's market.
Okay. What was so they talked about the causation and what's going on economically. Did they talk about solutions, creative real estate solutions, which is kind of our theme?
Yeah. Yeah. I was on a panel with a bunch of folks. So you may know John Jackson.
Sure.
Out of Texas.
Right.
So he was out there. There's a older gentleman named Ray. I forget his last name. But he was part of the Jim Napier. Who is the note guy?
Jimmy Napier was one of my favorite books, Invest in Debt.
There's another guy on options.
Zeckendorf. I've got three.
There's a guy that recently passed away, and I can't remember his name. He was out of Florida, I think.
Oh gosh.
He's the main guy that wrote all the books on options.
Yeah. I have three books on, by the way, people, it's in your Dropbox under the works package. All of you have that. If you don't, send me an email or I'll post it in the Skype group. We have three books on lease purchasing for the 21st century, mm-hmm. The Lease Purchase Bible. And I have another book on lease purchasing. It's a great strategy. So did they stress lease purchasing or talk about many strategies?
So they talked about many strategies.